output of them is sharing the things that you picked. And one thing that I need to mention at this point is that this study group is, we are not standing under one ideology or something like that. Each individual has their own orientation and their own perception. But it is a forum that helps us engage with the day-to-day realities of life. And it's something which helps us also, even in the process of our own essays here, by the way, it has made us become more critical and so on. So it's very helpful in that we form. So at this point, I would like to ask, especially for the new students or even the old batch who have never had the opportunity to interact with the study group, to ask any question. We're going to have a question and answer session whereby whichever doubts or clarification that you need can be made here or even later on. So you can ask any question either to Howard or to the professor, then they will answer, or any other person will be able to give feedback on whatever issues that you raise. So we take maybe about 3 or 4 questions, and if you want a particular question to go to a particular person, you ask that person. So that's how we do it. Thank you. It's an open session. So, yeah. Yes.
Could I please ask a question to Professor, if you could tell us a little about the refoundation of the Communist Party of the Philippines and the armed struggle, the beginning of the armed struggle, and its current standing?
Before the Communist Party of the Philippines was founded, there was a full decade of legal mass struggles. We used the mass, or when the mass movement was undertaken in order to recover from the destruction of the old revolutionary movement. Then, within the Communist Party of the Philippines, within the old one, the old Communist Party, that was a debate, no? The older ones in our community thought that legal mass movement would be indefinite, and simply we would have to wait for the time that a general offensive can be made by the people. But we, the younger ones, thought that that we could do legal mass movement up to a certain point, then we can decide. We can take the initiative in undertaking the people's war. So anyway, because of these differences, aside from, you know, the differences about the Sino-Soviet debate and so on, the debate between Marxism and artificialism, we have to deal with the history of the movement. And the elder ones, the ones we call the Lava group, was so defensive about the past because there was this history of three brothers. Oh, brilliant, they were brilliant, but they had the wrong line. Each brother had the wrong line. So one after the other, they became secretary general, and then in the committee, there were two nephews. And the other members were close associates of theirs in outside of the community. So it was a family affair, no? There were differences of positions in principle, and we had to, the old party could not be moved forward. So we have to reestablish the Communist Party of the Philippines. And we trace it back to the founding by the working class leader, Crisanto Evangelista. But with the big difference that we were supposed to be enjoying already in a situation where Marxism had gone through 3 stages of development, you know? Marxism of Marx and Engels laid the ground, the philosophical and political ground. Then, second stage, Leninism, the actual building of a socialist society, and this would extend to the post-World War II situation when one third of the world were consisted of people's democracies and socialist societies. And the period of Maoism, or Mao Zedong called the third one, was supposed to consist of contending with modern revisionism, preventing the restoration of capitalism and consolidating socialism. So, you know, what's good about Marxism of any stage, that it is holistic, integrated. The enemies of Marxism say, oh, it's totalitarian. it cannot be different from the invisible kind, no? Green, no? The capitalist system. And the point here is, you know, you have a system in which people help each other, together they build a new society. Anyway, you know, the advantage of knowing your past very deeply and being able to see the future is that you have a good view of the present. And so we try to get the best out of the thinking and experience of communist leaders when we built the Communist Party in the Philippines, or rebuilt it. And then, you know, we like to flatter ourselves that only 3 months after the establishment, we were serious enough to launch the armed struggle with only, how many? With only around 60 people sharing 9 rifles, automatic rifles, and 36 handguns and single shots. Yeah, in 1 year and a half, we were able to turn that into 200 rifles. But the armed struggle was intense, and of course the reaction was strong. But anyway, we were able to preserve the strength of the movement, and we were able to expand. So, how is it that we beginners, who had to begin in a very small part of the country, who make advances rapidly? Well, I suppose first you have to look at the reality of the Philippines. The crisis was already such that problems of the system could no longer be solved by the reactionary classes. Marcos had to declare martial law and impose fascist dictatorship on the country. That's how desperate the ruling system was. And then we thought that that the people were ready to fight, and the important thing is to have a party that could lead the people. The most important in developing a movement against a system is the main thing is to develop popular support. And this is where a lot of practicality comes in. Practicality, I don't mean pragmatism, here and there fixing things. Practicality in the sense that you see people with different levels of thinking, different conditions, and you must be able to approach them. That's a very exciting thing to do. I usually meet sometimes I meet Maoists, who are good at, who are good on doctrinal matters. They try to show themselves as highly principled, all that they do is to say that they have correct ideas against the ideas of others, no? They are, in fact, you may use certain labels, no? They have a dogmatic, bureaucratic, and sectarian approach. You see, and it's not surprising why they don't have a mass base. They don't have a strong mass movement going on. It's because they do not at all deal with the masses as having different levels of consciousness and different kinds of ideas. And it takes a good view of people. It takes skills to approach the people and unite them towards the a definite goal of revolution. And there are many ways. You know, you have the ideology or theory is nothing if it does not generate the political movement of the people. Theory is good for guiding, for setting the direction, but what can a few wise guys do, accomplish if they do not get the masses? And so you must have a general line for arousing, organizing, and mobilizing the people. And our general line is to pursue and complete the struggle for national liberation and democracy. It's something away yet from the communist goal, no? But it's something that you cannot skip. And then, but of course, it's good to have communist leaders because you get the best of the mass movement, develop it into a core, not only for the current struggles, but for future struggles. You know, the goal of socialism should not be missed. Making a revolution is all about getting the people on your side.